He has a plan, she has a plan, and you get to pay for it regardless.
The best way to get someone motivated is to stand for something strongly, deeply, passionately.
Subscribe to Disenthrall.
Do as you're told.
What is going on in here?
What are we doing, Dagny?
I'm taking Dagny's toenails.
Yep.
I am Patrick Pink Toenail Smith. And we're going to pretend that we don't know that for the rest of this event. What you just saw was four methods of activism. You saw a guillotine that we built. We pushed up the steps of a county courthouse, and we told the government who was boss. You saw a bunch of people feeding the homeless, which is illegal in Dallas, Texas, with a lot of guns to tell the cops what their job was that day. You saw media production, my channel Disenthrall, where we make media about philosophy and ethics. And you saw politics, where I ran a campaign for not governor of Texas to try and bring libertarian and voluntarist principles to that audience. Would not recommend. The answer, which of those four types of activism do you think is the most powerful, most efficacious in the world? The answer is none of them. The answer was the last one. The answer is parenting. Peaceful parenting. Principled parenting. That is why I'm here today. And I have a lot of points to cover, and I want to make sure I don't lose any of them, so with your permission, I'm going to keep my notes on my phone. I'm here today to arm my fellow activists with some of the most subversive tactics and information that I can. Stuff the government would really not like you to know about. How to create peaceful, principled peaceful voluntarism in your home and in your children's lives. So before I go any further, I want to thank Jeff Berwick for providing me with this opportunity to talk to you and hopefully influence some minds and some parents today. This event has been awesome. Would you agree? So it is my intention over the next 40 minutes to teach you three principles to apply to parenting. I'm not one of the people here to help you align your chakras. I am here to give real, practical parenting advice on how to solve actual solutions in a principled, peaceful way. The first thing I want to talk to you about, the first principle I want to teach you today is how to create markets. Some people say something that really bothers me. They say that communism only functions in the home, inside the family. Well, I'm here to tell you that communism doesn't even function there. Communism in the family causes almost as many problems inside your home as it does in the rest of the world, where it stacks bodies. And we need to get better at growing and protecting the free markets where it is most important, at home. So what does it mean to create a free market at home? Like everything else we talk about here, it begins with self-ownership. Every single person in my home, and I have two younger kids and one older, the two younger are still living with us, every single person in my home has sole ownership over themselves. There is no communal property in my home. Let me repeat that. There is no communal property in my home. Every single thing is owned by a specific person. Everyone has final say and control over every piece of property that they own. Okay, so what does this look like in practice, though? I mean, we gotta share, right? Well, let me give you some examples of how this works and the problems that free markets solve. My kids love trains, and that's a little ironic and quite hilarious because my two younger kids' names are Atlas and Dagny. And this crowd will get that. We didn't influence them or try and suggest that they get into trains. My son just latched onto them one day, and now my home is full of train tracks. But the problem is, anything that my son likes, my daughter also likes. And so we ended up getting them both train sets and little train pieces. Actually, in the beginning, we just bought a whole mess of train pieces. That was a disaster. That was communism. We had a batch of train tracks, and now they have to figure out who gets to use what when. And one kid would get a bunch of tracks, and they'd be building curves left, right, and up and down. The other one would need one of those parts, and they'd be like, well, I need that part. And they'd go over and start to try and take it. And the other kid would say, no, you can't have that. I'm using that right now. So you only own that which you're currently using. Where have we heard that? So what's the solution? Very simple. We assigned ownership of the pieces. Little letter A for the pieces that belong to my son, little letter D for the pieces that belong to Dagny. Now that sounds weird at first, because now they both have access to half as many train pieces, but that's not how it ends up working. Just like in the free market, the market finds a way. Now there is no dispute. Now they can build their train tracks on their own separately, and when they want to borrow a train piece, it's okay to loan them because they're secure in their ownership of those pieces, and they know they can get them back at any time just by saying, hey, I need my pieces back. No questions, no conflicts, that's what happens. Another example I want to give you is something that happens in every parent's life when you go to the store and your kids grab stuff off the shelves constantly. You know, they see a toy or something shiny and they run over and they pick it up and start messing with it, and parents are constantly like, put that back, no, we're not buying that, put that back, stop. Well, the conversation with my kids goes something like this, and you would be, I don't know if you'd be surprised or not to learn, but it's the same rule. It's consistent. Is that yours? No. Whose is that? It's the store's. Can you touch people's things without asking them? But I really want to touch it. Yeah, but if Dagny really wants to touch your stuff, does she get to? No. Okay. Problem solved. The last thing I want to talk about, the last example I want to give you for this, is my daughter and I have a tradition for her birthday. Every year, her and I, we go to the store together, and we pick out a cake, and she gets to choose how it's decorated. She gets to choose what color it is and what's written on it. And then it's her birthday cake, and we go take it home to the party, and we have the party. This year, she turned 5. She asked a question she had never asked before. Dad, I want to carry my cake to the car. Okay, so we have a 5-year-old girl, and we'll get more into this later, but she was diagnosed with leukemia. So she's going through chemotherapy. She has wobbly knees and weak fine muscle control. So the last thing any parent would want is this child trying to carry a cake out of a grocery store. We know what's going to happen. But here's the thing. The principle of the matter is that cake belonged to her. I didn't have a choice in the matter. So what did I do? It was her cake. But I'm still the parent. So what's the parent's job? The parent's job is to warn them. Dagny, you know we have kind of weak legs right now. Are you sure you don't want me to carry it? How about this, Dagny? If you hop in the cart, I'll push the cart and you can still hold the cake and I'll push you in the cart. No? Okay, you really want to walk with this cake. Got it. So now my job becomes looking ahead to see and predicting the future and seeing what's about to happen to her and what bad things might come, and be like, Dagny, there's a step down here. Watch out. Hey, let me hold your hand as we go down. Hey, here's a step up. Watch your step. You're about to knock, somebody's coming. I make sure people stay out of her way. What better picture of what a parent is supposed to do than this simple example? They own themselves. We embrace that. We don't get in the way of it. And then we spend our time coaching and warning and predicting. This had a happy ending. She, in the condition that she was in, carried that cake all the way to the cash register, all the way through the parking lot to the car, all the way in from the car at home and all the way into the kitchen and put her cake on the counter. And she did that with her cake for her birthday. Nice. What a growing experience that was for both of us. I could literally make a whole series of talks on the ways that creating a market at home helps you and your children live more peacefully, but we have to move on. The second principle I want to share today. Literally every parent has experienced this situation. When a child hits that state of complete emotional breakdown, it's physiological. They can't help it. The part of their brain hasn't developed yet that steps in when they're caught in an emotion loop and breaks them out of it and self-soothes. They don't have that capacity yet. So a little bad thing will happen and it will upset them. And then they'll be upset and they'll try and continue doing it and it'll fail more. Good example is my son, again with the train sets. He's way into advanced levels of building train sets at this point, folks. So he will stack random objects in the house to make little columns, and then he'll run the train tracks up the columns to have multi-level train sets. Of course, he's six, and he's not really good at gravity yet, and we call it fighting physics. My son loves to fight physics. He'll stack these blocks up, and they'll fall the moment he runs a train across them. And my God, that frustrates him. He doesn't understand what he's doing wrong or why they're falling, and so he'll just get angry and he'll stack them again, and then he'll get frustrated, and then he'll start crying, and then he'll start standing around just like, "Dad, they won't stand up!" And then he gets caught in this feedback loop. It's not his fault. He doesn't have the capacity to stop himself yet. His brain doesn't know how to control that cycle. We've all seen this. Every single child alive, every parent has seen this in every child of theirs. It's part of the human condition. So let me give you an example. Let me tell you literally how to handle this situation. And the secret is that it works on grown-ups too, but we're not going to talk about that today. Step one, stop. Because a parent's instinct is to be like, "Son, you're just not stacking them right. Stop crying, why are you yelling? It's just toys. Let me show you. And you grab the blocks and you restack them. They aren't even there with you. Their brain is stuck in a feedback loop. It's like a short circuit. It's just heating up and heating up. They don't care what you have to say. They don't want your advice in that moment. So you stop. You take a deep breath. You take all that shit that you wanted to say to them and teach them and instruct them and, you know, get them quiet and calm down, and you put that away. You don't need that. Then you get down on the floor. You get on their eye level. You look at them. And you do this. And you look at their face, and you see what emotions are on their face. And you say, "Son, you look so frustrated right now. You look so sad. Come here." And he'll come to you. I guarantee you they'll come to you. And they'll give you a big hug. And they'll say, "Dad, they won't stand up. I don't know what's wrong. They keep falling. Every time I stack them, they keep falling." "Oh, son, that's so hard. I know sometimes I've had projects where I've tried to make them work and they don't and they fall and it's so frustrating." "I know. Tell me about it." And just let him vent. Let him give you his whole emotional short circuit feedback loop. Let him feed it to you. Take it in. Hug him. Identify with him. Empathize with him. Repeat back the feelings that you see him experiencing to him. Give them names. This process trains his brain on how to soothe himself, which is the most powerful thing you can do in that situation. Then, once he's calm, there's plenty of time to say, "Son, would you like me to help you?" They'll probably say yes. Now they're open to instruction. Now they're ready to hear what you have to say and to learn about how to stack blocks better. So, remember, you cannot access your child's reasoning until you have welcomed and absorbed and diffused their emotions. This is another topic that deserves a lot more time, but we need to move on to the third principle I want to share today, which is awakening ownership. What is ownership? Ownership is the right to exclude others from the use of a thing. What is self-ownership then? the right to exclude others from the use of you. So how do we awaken self-ownership in children? How do we nurture that? Let me tell you a story. And this may get a bit intense, but I would not take you on this journey with me if I didn't think it was important. As I said earlier, my daughter Dagny was diagnosed with leukemia 2 years ago. We have treatments. She's been in treatment for 2 years. We were going to continue treatment for, I think, until October. She has chemotherapy every week. We go into the clinic. We call them clinic days. And what this looks like is you go to the clinic every Tuesday. You go into this place. There's a lot of the kids there also getting treatment. You go into a little room. And there's a list of things that they're going to do that day that they have sort of scheduled. And you're sitting in this little room with your kid who's nervous because nothing good ever happens to her in this place. And reverberating from the walls are the screams of the kids in the rooms next door. Because the matter of course in a place like this, as with many doctors, is they're used to just swooping into a room and saying, we need to do this, this, and this, and then they set about doing it. And if the child protests at all, the parent universally backs up the doctors and the nurses. Well, we just have to do it. The words that you hear are, let's just get it over with. Let's not draw it out. Just make it happen. Just make it happen and get it over with. So it's kind of like hell. You're in this place and these things are happening to these kids on both sides of you. Screams as they're held down and needles are forced into them and all this stuff. It's really difficult. So can you even parent from principles, the principles of voluntarism, of non-aggression, through a medical process that requires an endless multi-year marathon of terribly difficult, painful, scarring treatments, very non-optional treatments? Non-optional for very good reason, right? The answer is yes. We have done it. And if we can do it in this worst case scenario, there is no excuse of any parent out there in any kind of normal life scenario not being able to be a peaceful, principled parent. And I'm going to teach you how to do it by telling you the story of a typical clinic visit for chemotherapy for my daughter. The first step is preparation. We don't wake up on the morning of clinic day, roll my daughter out of bed, and say, we're going to clinic today. Throw her in the car and go. It's the worst thing you can do to any kid anywhere, anytime. We start 2 days before, at least 1 day before, and we call ahead. And we find out what the planned procedures are. Okay, they're going to do a blood draw. They're going to hook her up and they're going to give her XYZ medication. Maybe it's a procedure day, so they're going to put her unconscious. She hates that. And they give her a lumbar puncture and do the whole thing. So days in advance, we're talking to her. Hey, remember, 2 days we have a clinic day. Day before. Hey, this clinic day, it's going to be an easy one. We're just going to do a blood draw. You cool with that? Well, no, I don't like that. Okay. Well, what can we do to help? Can we apply some numbing cream to your arm so you don't feel the poke? What about chicky nuggies? What if we go to McDonald's on the way home? I hear they have a prize closet at the clinic. Maybe we can get them to let you pick a prize out of the prize closet. Days in advance, we're warning her of what we would like her to do. We're the farthest thing possible from springing on her. We're getting, and this is step two, we're getting her agreement, which is another way of saying we are getting her consent. And this works, if this works for the hospital, the grocery store is nothing. Get their consent. Don't spring stuff on them. Talk to them in advance. Make deals. Because she is your equal. She owns herself. Step three. This is at the clinic. So we're going to go to hell. Step three is the absolute defense of the child's consent at every step against any and all opposition in that building. When the doctor swoops in and the nurse comes in behind him and says, hey, today we need to do a blood draw, grabs her arm, starts wrapping the band around her upper arm and, you know, pulls out the scary, shiny needles, we say, no. Hold on. We need to make sure we're good here. The nurses do not like hearing that. The doctors are not used to being told, hold on, we need to talk about this, make sure we're good. But you know what? They work for me. You know what? That's my daughter's body, not his. She said no. Hold on. At every step of the way, without fail. And if she revokes her consent and says no in the middle of something, you know, we got our deal arrangement, and this happens a lot, because when those scary, shiny needles come out, phew, you rethink those chicken nuggies. We say, hey, nurse, take five. Let us have a minute to decompress. We're going to talk to her. We're going to talk through this. We're going to make sure that everything's chill. We're going to remind her about chicken nuggies and french fries and toys from the toy closet and whatever other deal that we made, maybe to go to the store or movies or whatever she wants. And eventually, usually, she agrees. Hey, and then we call them back in. They do not like being told to wait. I don't care. That's the difference between my little room in hell and the room of wailing and gnashing of teeth next door. Because my daughter, the nurse walks back in, she's thinking, oh, chicken nuggies, let's get this over with. Come on. And she gets her stuff done and we go home. Her self-ownership is intact. Her consent is intact. And her parents defend her. Whoa. There is nothing more healing, more bolstering, more powerful, or that strengthens your relationship with your child more than backing them up in the face of terrifying, painful things that are about to be done to them. Most parent groups that I've been in, when you fail, and you're like, guys, I messed up, I hit my kid, I was really angry, didn't know what to do. You're flooded with a bunch of people that come in and say, oh, everybody makes mistakes, don't worry about it. You'll do better next time. It's okay, cut yourself some slack. Parenting is stressful, parenting is hard. Kids are crazy sometimes. I think all of that is generally terrible advice. If we are to be peaceful, principled parents, we must own our mistakes and hold ourselves accountable in the same way that we would with anyone else. Kaysen, for example, he's in the back somewhere. If I went over there and I was mad at how he was pointing that camera at me and I swatted him across the ass, that's a bad example. And I punched him. Would a bunch of people swarm around me and be like, Patrick, it's okay, it was an intense moment, you were really angry, you'll do better next time, it's no big deal. Would Kaysen say it? Kaysen, would you say that?
I don't like that.
Do you? So I'm going to share a story that my wife was strong and brave enough to want me to tell you about. It's one of our failures because she thinks that it can be used to help people understand what failure looks like and where to go once it's happened. The next bit is really important, but it's going to be hard for me to get out. So please be patient with me. Okay, so it's clinic day. We've prepared her. Days in advance, we've gotten her consent, her agreement, we've plans for chicken nuggies. It's a really simple day. One of the easiest clinic days, blood draw. We get there, we show up, everything's cool. We go into our little box in hell, listening to the screams. This was actually my wife and my daughter Dagny. I was home at the time. And the nurse comes in and starts doing the poke. Well, after 2 years of treatments, she's got some scar tissue. Pokes are not quite as easy as they used to be. Today was particularly difficult. It took 15. And by the 15th poke, she still didn't have it. And my daughter was done. She was done. She said, no, stop. The nurses are totally used to hearing this. Every single child gets to this point and tells them no at some time. Guess what else they're also used to doing? Completely ignoring that. So she just says, okay, I'm sorry. I know this is painful. I'm just going to switch to the other arm. Moves to the other arm, grabs her arm, starts wrapping the band around it, and begins getting ready to draw blood from the other arm. Starts poking the other arm while my daughter is escalating. My wife is in the room. She's very conflict averse. A lot of people are like that. That's fine. But it's not okay when you're the protector. This day, she was weak. She didn't want to have the fight against the authority of the nurse. She didn't want to cause drama. She knew the place was busy. The nurse had other patients to get to. The other patients were waiting. We don't want to hold them up. Let's just get it done. Let's just make it happen. My daughter begins screaming, saying no. My son is in the room with them. And he runs to the door. They're telling me the story when I'm getting home through a series of... Something was wrong when they got home, so I started asking questions about what happened. And my son later tells me that he was over by the door of the room holding his ears because Dagny was screaming like the other kids. My wife failed. They made it happen. They came home. They told me about this. And you know, I'm asking probing questions. Why didn't you stop them? Well, I didn't know what to do. Was leaving the hospital not an option? I'm angry, righteously angry. My heart is breaking. I talked to my daughter, and I started walking through the process with her. And the process for walking her through this stuff and talking to her about it is very similar to the one that we talked about earlier. Get down on her level, or bring her up to yours. In this case, I put her up on the counter so that I could talk to her eye to eye. As equals. Ask mostly questions. Start at the very beginning, talk through everything. Especially the things that she felt. You're looking for the damage. So you got to the clinic. You guys had an agreement, you were gonna get chicken nuggies, then what happened? Well, the nurse came in and she started trying to poke. And Dad, I didn't ask for the numbing cream that day because I was tough. And she is. She's been doing it for 2 years. A poke isn't usually a big deal. But then it got bad. She kept poking. She didn't have enough, or she wasn't finding the vein. And Dagny said that, you know, I said no. And then they kept doing it. And I said, Dagny, was that okay? She said one of the worst things I've ever heard her say. Dad, I don't know. So because my wife sat in the room and let that happen, for her to say no, that wasn't okay, would be to also judge her mother for standing by and doing nothing. So she didn't know anymore. Her lens on consent had been knocked out of alignment. Her self-ownership had been partially unlearned. She went from sure to not being confident, because let me tell you, the day before, if something like that had happened, and I said, was that okay? She'd be like, no, that wasn't okay. But now it was, I'm not sure. So, we've identified the damage. Now how do we go about healing that? We've failed. Now how do we make it as good as we can? Well, surprisingly, it's very similar to how you would make it better with a friend of yours, right? The four parts of a real apology. We don't have time to talk about it today, but it's basically you admit guilt, you own your mistakes, you show contrition. I messed up. I'm sorry. That was bad. That was wrong. Restitution. Find ways to make it better. What can we do to make you feel better about what happened? And reconfiguration, which is where you think about things that you can change in your life such that the next time that happens, you can tell them what your process will be to make sure it doesn't go that way again. So that's the basics. It involves a lot of talking. It's not fast. It's not overnight. The biggest thing is no more failing in that way ever again. It's not okay. Don't cut yourself some slack. Don't do that again. How many parents actually look at their kids and admit that they were wrong and apologize? Why is it so few? We expect them to say they're wrong and apologize when they mess up. Good. Good. We expect them to do that, but we don't? What? So, you won't heal them in a day. I won't fix this in a day. It's like recording over a tape. You know, you can erase it, but sometimes you'll still hear a ghost of the previous recording, so you might need to erase it several times before you lay down the next recording. It's kind of how the brain works. And so what we do is we look for ways to reinforce her consent. We look for opportunities to ask to get her consent that maybe we otherwise wouldn't have worried about, just to let her say yes or no, to show that we will follow what her consent says. Next time we're at the hospital, we'll get in cahoots with one of the nurses that we're friends with to have her swoop into the clinic room with something that she wants to do and be like, Dagny, we're about to do this. Pull out the scary things. And Dagny says no. And we said, oh, get out. She said no. It's a long process, but it's possible. Now, with the 4 minutes I have left, I want to tell you a story of when it goes right, of when these principles come back around and show themselves in the little tiny humans that you're creating. So my family, my son loves to skateboard. He's been learning. He's only six, so he's not great yet, but that's awesome. He's really out there trying to learn. We went to a family trip to a skate park. We were over having a picnic. My son was off skateboarding. Now, you know, skateboard parks are usually full of kids of all ages. Most of them go to public schools and were not parented peacefully. And, you know, some of them can be bullies and such. So we're sitting over here, and across the playground I hear yelling, and I see my son on his little skateboard, he's a little guy, going after, like, I mean, like, trying to run his skateboard over this big kid. And so I get up and I run across the playground really fast. I'm like, what's going on? And as I run up, I hear my son yelling at this older kid, if you get to do something to me that I don't like, then I get to do something that you don't like. It's the principle that we've been teaching. He didn't look around for an authority figure. He didn't look around for a teacher to come and help him and to tell him who was right and who was wrong. He knew what was right and what was wrong. He was telling the other kid that was twice his age what was right and what was wrong, and he was handling business. So I walk up and I'm like, what's going on? And he tells me, and the other kid's like, yeah, I squirted him, and he told you to stop, and did you stop? No. And this kid doesn't care, he walks off. And I'm like, son, you gotta be careful sometimes. We'll talk about that later. But what we just witnessed was what I talked about in the beginning. It's why principled, peaceful parenting is the most powerful form of activism. Because I'm not creating humans that will become adults that expect an all-seeing eye authority to control their life. A thing that will always be there to protect them, look over their shoulder, and that they have to ask permission for everything from. When they become adults, they won't even know what that is or what that looks like. And when that's subjected to them, they'll be like, that is wrong. Go away, gross. Yeah. That's why it's the most powerful form of activism. So when I started parenting, my toolbox was totally empty. I learned that I had to become a peaceful parent. That was imperative, that was not optional, but I had no clue how to do it, and that was terrifying. I've learned the hard way, things that I would have given a lot to know years ago, but the resources were scarce and hard to find, and I'm gonna change that. I would like to announce the Peaceful Parenting University. I'm going to create and compile content like you have seen here today, starting from square one, to give parents a fully loaded toolbox so that no one will have to be caught empty-handed like I was again. I'm hosting monthly workshops and roundtables where parents can meet together and talk, share experiences, share troubles, share tips that they've learned and things that they've learned. Because at the Parenting University, we're all professors. There's no students. It's too late to be students. We're professors, and we're just going to help each other get through it and learn to be the best that we can. I'm creating a massive, ever-growing video library talking about things like this today and a whole long list of other things. I'm offering one-on-one coaching sessions for when you would like focused assistance. The university will be launching very soon, and the people here at Anarchapoco, I think, are the early adopters. So I want to make sure that as we launch this in the coming weeks, that you guys are in on it first, and I want to give you guys a special rate because I trust you guys to be the seeds that when this thing goes out to the rest of the world, there will already be a principal group of people ready to welcome them and make sure that they stay on the right path. So if you'll go to the website, www.peacefulparentinguniversity.com, drop your email address in there. When it launches, you will get an offer that no one else in the history of time, as long as I do this, will ever get. So just toss me your email address and you'll be notified. Now, let me teach you one last tip before I go. 4 seconds, it's gonna be fast. And we can chat later about why it's important. But my daughter wanted to share something with you. She asked me to share this with her. Something that I think all families should have. A family motto.
We miss, we tough, we cry when we need to.
She asked me to send that to you guys. Have a family motto. Spend the rest of your time here trying to think of one for your family. Teach it to your kids. Be proud of it. Let's go be the best parents we can be. I have been Patrick Smith. Oh, thank you.